The title of this talk is Revolution and Counter-Revolution in Latin America, but as you might have noticed, there is a question mark at the end. So what I'm going to be trying to argue is that in Venezuela there's been a long cycle of revolution in different degrees of intensity in different countries, which has lasted for the best part of 15 years, 15, 16 years. And now we are in a different juncture. I do not agree with the idea that we have entered a shift to the right in Latin America, or that revolution has finished and we're now entering a counter-revolution. But it's quite clear for anyone who's been observing events that the situation has changed. About a year ago, we saw the defeat of the Bolivarian candidates in the National Assembly elections in Venezuela. Immediately before that, there was the defeat of the Kirchnerist candidate in the Argentinian elections. Right now, there are presidential elections in Ecuador, and the presidential candidate of the ruling party, Alianza País, has not won automatically in the first round. It has to go to the second round, and it's not very clear whether he's going to be able to win or not. So the situation is a bit different from the previous situation of about 15 years, where it seemed that the whole of Latin America was turning to the left. You saw electoral victories of left-wing governments and movements, the people in the streets overthrowing right-wing governments, defeating privatization plans, and so on. And I will say that first we need to analyze why there was this long period of turn to the left in Latin America and when did it start. There are different points which you could pick as the starting point of this wave, but I would say that around the turn of the century, around the year 2000, there were a whole series of important events happening in different countries that could mark the beginning of this wave. The first one that you could mention is the election of President Chavez in Venezuela in 98. And the election of President Chavez in Venezuela kind of opened the floodgates for the rest of the process in other countries. And the election of Chavez in 98 was the end result of another process that had started in Venezuela in 89. In 89, as you might know, there was a big uprising in Venezuela called El Caracazo. And this uprising was against a package of measures, an IMF dictated package of measures that the Carlos Andrés Pérez government introduced in February 89. And these measures were basically the lifting of subsidies on basic food products, the lifting of subsidies on fuel, privatization of state-owned companies, and so on. What we generally know as neoliberal policies. It was a package of neoliberal policies, but this provoked an uprising of the people. Now, you have to understand that the year 89 was also important for other reasons. It was the year of the fall of the Berlin Wall, the collapse of Stalinism in the East from 89 to 91. At that time, it seemed that capitalism had won, or so told us the editorial in the Financial Times, we have won. And that there was the end of history, as Francis Fukuyama said, which he later has retracted from. And it seemed that there was no alternative, that the only policies possible were the policies of privatization, the policies of Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. And in Latin America, there was a process for about 10 years, which was known as the lost decade, basically of recolonization of the whole continent by the United States, by Spain, by European Union companies that took over the management of water companies, telephone companies, banking operations, and so on. If you look throughout Latin America now, quite a lot of the main banks, telephone companies, gas, natural gas, and oil companies are foreign-owned. And quite a lot of this process took place in the years between 1980 and the year 2000. And so I will say that the coming to power of Hugo Chavez in 98 opened a process where the pendulums swung to the other extreme. The people started to fight back against privatization, against colonization, against neo-imperialism, against the opening up of the markets ideology, and so on. And it was a reaction against these 10 years that were lost for Latin America. Lost in the sense that the living standards of the majority of the population went down, while the multinationals were extracting natural resources, sources of energy, and enriching themselves massively on the basis of the privatization of state-owned assets. In 2000, in January, right at the beginning of the century, we saw the revolution in Ecuador. There was a huge movement that lasted for about 2 months, mainly organized around the peasant indigenous organization, CONAIE. The people started to organize people's assemblies. They finally converged on the capital, and by the end of January, there was an uprising that affected the army, and the old government, the government of Jamil Mahuad, was overthrown. This has been a government that had been introducing these policies that we know as neoliberal capitalist policies of privatizing everything and basically making the people pay for the crisis of capitalism. And people had had enough. And it was the interesting thing, I would say, the thing that makes this movement very important is that this was not just the people protesting on the streets and demanding a change in policies, but they organized themselves in a people's assemblies. There was a national people's assembly, and basically they overthrew the elected government. This government had been elected democratically through bourgeois democratic elections, but was overthrown not by an election, but by the decisive intervention of the masses in events. And I will say that's what makes this a revolutionary event. This was not the end of the story for Ecuador, because the person who came to power as a result of this revolutionary overthrow of the previous government was Lucio Gutierrez, an army officer who put himself at the head of this movement. And he, in turn, was then overthrown in 2005 because instead of fulfilling the will of the people in this uprising, he changed and implemented, again, neoliberal policy. So he was overthrown in 2005. And in 2006, we saw the election of Rafael Correa. And the beginning of a big movement that is called the Citizens' Revolution, a movement, big movement of change and direct participation of people in politics in Ecuador. This was Venezuela, Ecuador. Then we had Bolivia, is another important country in this wave. And in the year 1999-2000, we had what was known as La Guerra del Agua, the water war in Cochabamba. And this was as the result of the attempt of the government to privatize the management of water, which will have made water very expensive for people in the households, but also for peasant farmers to use the water, which became very expensive. The water bills went up by 400% overnight. And so the people again organized. And it wasn't just, as in Ecuador, it wasn't just a question of people wanted a change of policies. The people took direct action. They occupied the main square in Cochabamba for weeks on end. And they basically overthrew this attempt to privatize water by direct action. And this changed the mood in Bolivia. From a mood where people had been suffering many defeats, the defeat of the miners' strike in 85, a whole series of defeats, this was the first victory that opened the floodgates for other struggles. In 2003, in two phases, we had 2003 and then 2005, we had what was known as the gas war, where people fought against the privatization of gas to a foreign multinational, natural gas being one of the main natural resources in Bolivia. And this was again a revolutionary event. In October 2003, the people had marched from across the country, setting up again popular assemblies, marched to the capital, La Paz. And then in October, the miners arrived in the capital with dynamite sticks. The miners are the most militant, well-organized section of the working class in Bolivia, with revolutionary traditions going back to 1952. And the people from El Alto, which is this working class, an indigenous city on top, which sits on top of the capital, La Paz, they marched down, and the government attempted to stop them by the use of the army. People were killed, several dozen people were killed in this struggle. But finally, they forced the government to backtrack, and the government was overthrown. At that time, the workers and peasants in Bolivia could have taken power. But this didn't happen. There was another wave of the war, the gas war, in June 2005, which led to the overthrow of another government. And finally, as a byproduct of all this mobilization, we saw the election of Evo Morales, President Evo Morales, at the head of the Movement for Socialism in December 2005. And he's still the president today. In Argentina, we also saw a similar movement in December 2001, which was known as El Argentinazo, big uprising of the people, again against the neoliberal package of measures introduced by the De La Rúa government. After many years, again, of defeats, people came out on the streets, they took the capital, they set up popular assemblies in the neighborhoods, and the government was overthrown. Not only one government was overthrown, but in the space of 3 weeks, the people got rid of five different presidents that they didn't want because they didn't respond to what the people in the streets wanted. And again, as a byproduct of this revolutionary uprising, we saw the election of Néstor Kirchner in 2003. So again, as I say, all these are revolutionary events that in one way or another lead to the overthrow of governments, the election of left-wing governments that claim or want to respond to the will of the people on the streets. Similar situation we saw in Peru, for instance, where there was an uprising in all the southern provinces, in Arequipa and other provinces in the south, against the privatization of electricity, which was defeated. And the long wave of this Arequipazo produced finally in 2011 the election of Ollanta Humala to the presidency. And this was a short-lived experience. As I said, I mean, the situation is not exactly the same in every single of these Latin American countries, but it has some common features. The direct participation of the masses in the streets, the rejection of neoliberal, what is known as neoliberal policies. And from 2005 as well, we saw for the first time the beginning of a big discussion about socialism. Socialism of the 21st century, Bolivarian socialism, but socialism was back on the agenda, not being discussed in small rooms of half a dozen people in university, but discussed by millions of people throughout the continent. What is socialism? Socialism is the alternative to capitalism. What kind of socialism do we want? And this was a very important development. There are many other events that can be put together in this revolutionary wave. But I think that I mentioned the ones that I think are most important. But we also saw, at a different level, the election of Lula in Brazil in 2002. This was the first time that the Workers' Party managed to get a president elected in a country that's the largest country in Latin America, a country of tens of millions of people, that for the first time a person who was not a professional politician, who had been a trade unionist, a metal worker, was elected to run a country of 100 million people. And this was also very significant. Although the policies that he followed were nowhere as radical as the policies that were followed, for instance, in Venezuela or other countries. But the election of Lula was very significant because all the powers that be, the capitalists, the media, the land owners, the bank owners, the US State Department, they were all against him. They didn't want his election and they managed to defeat him once. Finally, he got elected. In Mexico in 2006, we saw a massive struggle against election fraud, which mobilized hundreds of thousands, millions of people for 6 weeks were occupying the center of the capital. And at the same time that this big struggle was taking place, there was also what was known as the Oaxaca Commune in Oaxaca, organized and led by the teachers' union, but this was an uprising in which the teachers, together with the population in general, the workers, the peasants, the indigenous population, they again set up a people's assembly, the assembly of the peoples of Oaxaca, as it was known, the APO, and they took over control of the whole of the state for months on end, from August until December 2006. This was again a revolutionary development. Now, this was the general trend throughout the decade. We also saw the massive strikes for free education in Chile, which was also a turning point in Chilean social movements. and other movements like that. Throughout this period of 10 or 15 years, we saw again attempts at military coups, the attempt to overthrow these governments by force. But in general, these attempts were failed. And this was a new thing. In Latin America, there have been many left-wing governments, there have been many revolutionary developments, but generally, the development will be like this. A left-wing government is elected, attempts to carry out some radical measures, including perhaps the nationalization of some of the main assets in their country. The United States embassy organizes a coup together with the capitalists and the landlords, and this government is overthrown in the space of 3 or 4 years. Tens of thousands of people are killed, exiled, and assassinated by a military dictatorship. This didn't happen in this period, or that was not the general trend. There were some coups, but these coups were mostly defeated, like the coup in Venezuela in 2002 and other attempted coups, the coup in Bolivia in 2008, the coup in Ecuador in 2010. Some were successful, like for instance the removal of President Aristide in Haiti, the removal of President Zelaya in Honduras, which was organized directly by with the participation of Hillary Clinton. And also the coup in Paraguay, which removed President Lugo. But in general, the trend was the masses managed to resist any attempts at coups, which was not because the coups were badly organized. They were classic coups with the participation of the mass media, the hierarchy of the Catholic Church, the United States Embassy, the capital. But the people managed to resist this coup. And there was a very high level of political participation, political consciousness and awareness and political discussion in all these countries. And on the basis of this, on the back of these movements, massive social reforms were implemented in many of these countries. I'm going to concentrate mainly on Venezuela because I think this is the place where the process went further and was more profound and had a bigger impact. I have brought a few copies of this for shorthand. And it's just basically a summary of some of the main achievements of the Bolivarian Revolution, which I'm just going to mention in passing. First of all, there was a massive expansion of university education, which in Venezuela is free for everyone, as in contrast with what we have in this country, where tuition fees were introduced in more or less the same period, and then were massively increased. So in Venezuela, they've gone from 800,000 higher education students in 1998 to 2.6 million in 2013. And there has been an effort to create new universities and so on. Poverty was reduced from 48 to 27%. Illiteracy was eradicated in 2005 in a massive campaign with the help of Cuban methods of fighting against illiteracy. Malnourishment was reduced from 21 to 5%. Privatized utilities and state enterprises were renationalized. The number of people receiving old age pensions, which in Latin America are not universal by any stretch of imagination, the number of people receiving state pensions massively increased. There was a massive program to bring health care to the working class and poor areas in the cities and in the rural areas. And even more recently, I think it's about 3 million homes have been built and delivered to people who previously were in bad housing conditions or living or homeless or whatever. So this was very important, but I think that even beyond the material gains of the Bolivarian Revolution, perhaps the most important thing was that there was a process of political participation and organization of people who traditionally had been excluded from politics. So people set up communal councils, urban land committees. They took direct action to take over the land from the landed from the big landowners. Workers occupied factories and managed them under workers' control. And there was a widespread, as I said before, discussion about socialism. And people were talking about this all the time. And this was what Chavez said in 2005. He said, look, I've reached the conclusion that within the limits of capitalism, we cannot solve the fundamental problems of the people are facing in our countries. And the way forward is socialism. So this was the first time since the collapse of Stalinism in the East, in Russia and Eastern countries, that an elected head of state at the head of a revolutionary movement involving millions of people said that we must go towards socialism. And this had an impact not only in Latin America, but also beyond Latin America. I remember when President Chavez came to speak in London, there was a massive meeting at the Camden Center, and people were really enthusiastic because over here not much was happening at that time. Similar policies were being implemented, privatization, casualization, attacks on workers' rights and so on, but there wasn't a big opposition movement at that time. And so Venezuela appeared like an example of what should be done and what could be achieved. And this movement also, it has to be mentioned, preceded movements that took place later, like the Arab Revolution in 2011, and then the Occupy and the Indignados movement, the movement in Greece and so on, which were partly inspired to a certain extent by what was happening in Latin America. Why is it, I think it's important to try to understand, why is it that this wave lasted for so long, maybe 10 or 15 years, and it was undefeated, and it seemed to be going forward all the time? There are many different factors. One is the relative weakness of US imperialism, in the sense that at the same time that all this was happening, US imperialism was concerned with two wars that they haven't won, in Afghanistan and Iraq. So they weren't exactly distracted because they were organizing the coup in Venezuela in 2002 and all these things, but they couldn't really commit, say, troops for a direct military intervention. And by the end of the decade, the mood in America, the mood in the United States, had turned towards a mood of no support for foreign military intervention, which is a problem that they have now. Still, from the point of view of the ruling class in the United States. But there is another factor, which I think is very, very important to understand, and this is that this coincided with a period of very high prices for oil and for natural resources, for raw materials, and for the commodities, which are the main sources of income of most of these countries. And I've also brought a few bits of paper here, which you can pass around. There's two of them. Which is basically a graph of the main the prices of the main commodities over this period of time, 2000 to 2016. And you can see, for instance, this is oil prices. Oil prices went up to record levels, $140, $160 a barrel, having been very, very low, for instance, at the time when Chavez won the election. The price of the oil barrel was under $40 a barrel, and then it went up to over 160, 140, 160, and then for a long period of time it was stabilized at around 120. But it's now collapsed again, and this has also an impact on this revolutionary wave. The same can be said for the price of natural gas, which is a main export, for instance, for Bolivia. The price of soybeans, which is a main export for Argentina, the price of zinc and tin, which is a main export for Bolivia, the price of copper, which is a main export for Chile. Oil also plays an important role in the case of Ecuador and other countries. And one of the reasons for this was the big pull, the massive economic growth in China, which was sucking in all these natural resources, sources of energy, and so on. And the countries, particularly in the Pacific coast of Latin America, were exporting and building links with China in a very serious way. You can see in these figures, if you look at it, that there was a recession. Obviously, there was a worldwide recession in 2007, 2009. This had an impact. But even after that, the prices went up again, and China continued to grow. But now this has come to an end. China's not growing at the same pace as it was growing before. It's now been severely hit by the crisis of capitalism worldwide, because the Chinese economy is also based, to a large extent, in exporting cheap goods to advanced capitalist countries of the US and the European Union. If there is a recession in the European Union where the economy is not growing at all, people can't buy these products, and therefore this has a knock-on effect in China and has a knock-on effect on the prices of these raw materials. There are other reasons why the price of oil has gone down, But this might be a bit too complicated. The point is that the price of oil has gone down from 120 to under 40, is about 40, 45 now, but the price of Venezuelan oil last year was $27 per barrel at its lowest point in 1 year ago, in February 2016. And Venezuelan oil is different from the oil in Saudi Arabia, for instance. In Saudi Arabia, you make a hole in the ground and you very quickly get oil. In Venezuela, the oil is much more profound, is more difficult to extract in most of the places, particularly in the Orinoco Basin. It's extra heavy oil, which needs to be refined, so it's more expensive to take from the ground. And it's calculated, more or less, that the price of Venezuelan oil, the cost of production, is about $25 a barrel. So for a period of time last year, it was almost not worth producing oil in Venezuela, and the Venezuelan state depends 95% of its foreign currency, hard currency income, comes from oil exports. Venezuela is extremely dependent on oil exports. So when these things started to happen, more or less around 2013, 2014, this had a big impact on the political process. The governments that had used this natural resources bonanza to fund all these social programs were no longer able to do it in the same way. And so this, I would say, is a big factor. Many of these countries entered into a recession. Some entered a deep recession. But not only countries that had revolutionary governments, like Venezuela, also countries that had reformist, social democratic at best governments, like Brazil. You can't describe the government of Lula and Dilma as a revolutionary government, although it implemented some social reforms, but it also implemented massive cuts in social security, in workers' rights, and many other things. And it's a government that also aligned itself in a certain degree with the policies of the United States. We have to remember that, for instance, all these people who organized the impeachment and the removal of Dilma in Congress, the same people who were in Dilma's government coalition, including Temer. So this gives you an idea of what kind of policies they were being implemented before. It was an unholy alliance between the Workers' Party and some capitalist parties that was implementing a policy that was not satisfying the needs of the masses. But however this might be, it's quite clear that the illusion that you could have what some described as oil socialism, i.e. that you could just use the oil resources to implement massive social reforms, which was very positive for 10 years, was not sustainable. The minute the oil prices go down, you can't continue with the same policies. And this is what has failed in Latin America. And we saw, as I said before, in November, December 2015, the election in Argentina, where Macri defeated the Kirchnerist candidate. Kirchnerist candidate who was also from the right wing of the party. So the idea that you can present, you can moderate your policies and then win an election was also completely defeated in this case. The election was very, very close, but it was a defeat. In December 2015, we saw the defeat in the National Assembly elections in Venezuela. And I would like to make a point about this, because some people say, okay, there's a conservative wave throughout Latin America, there's a shift to the right. People who used to vote for the left, now they're voting for the right. And I don't think that this is correct. This does not reflect what is actually happening if you look at the figures. In Venezuela, if you compare the 2015 National Assembly election and the 2013 presidential election, which was very hotly contested election, but the Bolivarian candidate Maduro won, you will see that the PSUV, the Bolivarian candidate, lost 2 million votes in between these two elections, but the opposition candidate, opposition coalition, the MUD, only won 0.5 million votes. So it's not really true that people shifted from a left-wing candidate and voted now for a right-wing candidate. It's mostly that people who used to vote for the left-wing candidate, for the revolutionary candidate, now abstain. They were disillusioned for one reason or another that we should discuss, and while the opposition managed to hold its votes or win a small proportion of additional votes. And I think that you can say this for most of these elections. I think it was the same in Argentina. It's largely the same in the recent election in Ecuador, and so on and so forth. It was the same, for instance, in Bolivia with the defeat of the constitutional amendment referendum in February 2016, and so on. But the truth is that now we have, in a number of countries, the election victory, not because people are enthusiastic about these candidates of the right wing, but they have won the election, mostly by default, by the demoralization or disillusionment of the voters of the left-wing parties and candidates. I would say that the Venezuelan case is the most striking in all of this. In Venezuela, there is now a massive economic crisis, an economic crisis that in any other country will have already led to an uprising, the overthrow of the government, and so on. But in Venezuela, has not been the case. And the crisis is very, very deep. There is a massive contraction of GDP, which has now gone on for 3 years. You could say probably that the GDP has contracted by 20% in the last three or four years, since 2013. There is a massive problem with scarcity of basic goods and food and medicine. And many of the gains of the revolution are starting to be reversed as a result of this massive economic crisis. The economic crisis can trace its roots mainly to the collapse in the price of oil. And I will try to demonstrate this. This is a graph. You might not be able to see from the back of the room, but I hope you can see that this graph goes down very sharply, and it's a graph that shows the foreign currency reserves of Venezuela. This graph is not amongst the ones I gave out. Didn't have time to make all the photocopies, but I can then show you if you want. But basically, in 2009 was the peak of the oil boom in Venezuela, in the sense that the state had accumulated $43 billion of foreign currency reserves, and it was downhill from then. But particularly from 2013, where reserves were at 30 billion, from 2013 there's been a massive collapse in foreign reserves. They've gone down to 15 billion, that is, they halved by 2016 beginning, and by the end of 2016, now, foreign currency reserves are at $10 billion, and Venezuela has to pay. And most of this is now no longer liquid, but in gold reserves that the state has to sell and transform into money. And Venezuela has to pay in foreign debt obligations this year $7 billion. Am I saying this right? Yeah, $7 billion in foreign debt commitments by PDVSA and the Venezuelan state. And this means that by the end of this year, by half of this year, this will be finished. There will be no more foreign currency reserves unless if all other factors remain the same. Say, for instance, if oil was to massively jump in price to $80 a barrel, which some people in the government think this is going to happen, but I think it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. This is my opinion. We can discuss more about why, but it's not going to happen. And in fact, oil prices in the last few weeks have already started to go down, despite the fact that the OPEC countries and Russia reached an agreement for cutting production. So this means that for a long period of time, the policy of the state in Venezuela was to import food and then sell it at subsidized prices. There were price controls in Venezuela, and so most of the basic food products, maize, flour, milk, eggs, powder milk for children, and many products were had regulated, half are still regulated prices. These regulated prices were only maintained on the basis of the state spending a lot of money from oil revenue through importing food and then selling it at subsidized prices to the people so that people didn't suffer from inflation. And there was a massive increase in the consumption of, general consumption of food by the people, but particularly the diet composition changed towards more meat and so on. People who were not, people who are now eating three times a day and so on. But in as much as the state does no longer have the money to continue this policy, this, I will say, is one of the main causes of scarcity. In 2 years, the state has cut in half the money it uses for imports of food and basic products. And this is the reason why this food cannot be found at the regulated prices, and therefore it is a massive pull towards the black market. If the state was able to sell maize flour at regulated prices to satisfy the demand of the people, there will be no black market. This is the reason why there is a black market. Black market is also the result of corruption and hoarding, deliberate political sabotage on the part of the opposition. But all those factors already existed for 10 years. And the state was able to overcome these factors because it was able to import the necessary amount of food to supply the demand from the people. As a result of this, the state has also gone into a massive budget deficit. Now, if you followed, for instance, the debates around the European Union and the Maastricht Treaty criteria, in Europe it is considered that the budget deficit should not be higher than 3% of GDP, i.e. the deficit of the state, the difference between what the state spends and what the state receives as income from tax and so on, in 1 year should not be higher than 3% of GDP. The budget deficit in Venezuela today, and it has been like this for 2 or 3 years, is over 10% of GDP, and I think now it has reached 15% of GDP. This is a completely unsustainable situation. Not only this, but the state has used the policy of printing money, i.e. increasing massively the money supply, in order to be able to pay for wages of state employees and so on. And so now there is I don't know if you're very familiar with this, but what happens in a normal economy, all other factors being equal, if you massively increase the amount of money circulating, the value of each piece of this money goes down massively. I.e. if you produce 100 and you have 100 bolivars, each product will be worth one bolivar. If you then put another 100 bolivars in the economy without increasing production, at a time when production is decreasing by 5% every year, you put 200 bolivars on the economy, then 300, and then 400, as happened last year. Last year the money supply multiplied by 3 or 4 in 1 year. Therefore, you have massive inflation, which is what you have now in Venezuela. The last year that inflation was recorded was in 2015, if I remember correctly, and inflation was already 180%. They've stopped producing figures, but inflation is now probably, well, I don't know, I mean, there's different, there's some Venezuelans in the room, they can maybe have a guess, but there's unofficial figures that say that inflation might be 800% or 400%, as people say inflation is 1,000% a year. This is completely unsustainable. If you take, for instance, the increases in the minimum wage that the government has decreed, you will see that at the very least, inflation is 400%. The minimum wage about 1 year ago, if I remember correctly, was about 18,000 bolivars. It is now, including the food bonuses that go with the wage, is about 80,000, is it? I think. So, I mean, from 18,000 to 80,000 is multiplied by 4, more or less. And here it is, this other graph, is the graph of the money supply. The M2 measure of money supply tells us that in 2016, there were 4 trillion bolivars in circulation in Venezuela. By the end of the year, there were 11 trillion bolivars, multiplied nearly by 3. And this is one of the causes, one of the causes of this massive hyperinflation and the scarcity of basic products. And this is a byproduct I mean, is mainly the result of the collapse in oil prices and the inability of the government to continue with the previous policies. But at the same time, you see, if you have control of foreign exchange in a country where people want to take the money out of the country, then you create a massive black market. And right now, the black market is completely out of control for the dollar exchange. I think it's now, it hovers around 3,000 bolivars to the dollar, 2,700, I think is the most recent figure. But it was, at the end of last year, reaching 4,000. The official exchange rate, the floating one, is about 700 or 800. But the official subsidized exchange rate for the importation of basic products is about 10. It used to be 8, it's now 10, and so on. So, some people say socialism has failed. I will say socialism never existed in Venezuela. In Venezuela, for all these years, there were nationalizations of some factories. Workers took over some other factories and ran them under workers' control. But the main character of the policy of the government in Venezuela, even though Chavez said we must go to socialism, we must put an end to the capitalist economy, this never actually happened. There was a vibrant private sector. Most of these dollars that have disappeared from the foreign currency reserves of the country have gone into the private sector. I'm a private capitalist, I go to the government, I say I'm going to import parts for the car industry, and the government gives me subsidized dollars, 10 bolivars per dollar. But if the black market exchange rate is 3,000, I'm not going to be bringing car parts. I'm going to be bringing a container full of scrap metal, which is much cheaper than car parts. And the rest of the money I'm going to sell in the black market, making a massive profit. I mean, imagine, I get dollars at 10 bolivars, and I sell them at 3,000. I don't know if anyone is able to calculate the profit rate I'm making here. And since I'm a capitalist, I don't care about anything else. I only care about making profit. Well, that's what I do. And this is one of the main problems of the Venezuelan economy now. But, however, just to conclude, what I will say is that this is not the failure of socialism. It's the failure of the attempt to regulate capitalism, i.e. to run a capitalist economy on the basis of trying to make the capitalist produce for the interest of the people by putting price controls, by putting foreign exchange controls. I'm not saying that these controls were bad. The controls were a necessary defensive measure that was introduced in 2002 when the capitalists were organizing an uprising against the government and sabotaging the economy. This was a necessary measure. What I'm saying is that these measures did not go far enough. I mean, in Venezuela, there is one company that controls most of the food production and distribution and processing, which is Polar. And everyone knows this. And everyone knows that Polar is participating in the sabotage of the economy. Polar has been denounced by Chavez, by Maduro, every year. Everyone knows. But no measures have been taken against Polar. I mean, if Polar controls 50% of the production of maize flour, and the government imports maize, and maize is processed in mills that belong to Polar, and then is put into packages by Polar, and never reaches the market at the price that the government has fixed, what do you do? As a measure of self-defense, you expropriate Polar. You expropriate, and then you expropriate the 100 companies that control 90% of the Venezuelan economy and banks and so on, and then you can use the resources of the country, human, material, agricultural and so on, to produce for the benefit of the people, not for the private profit of a small minority who never accepted the Bolivarian Revolution and worked for 15 years to overthrow it. The problem is that the government never took these measures, or never took these measures enough. And now, while this was possible in the past, because oil subsidized all these social investments, which were very positive, and completely transformed Venezuela and the lives of Venezuelan poor, who are millions, now this is no longer possible. And the same policy is being implemented by the government, and I have to say this, look, I have spent a lot of time, or most of my time in the last 15 years, defending the Bolivarian Revolution in meetings, trying to organize in different countries. I'm the secretary of the Hands Off Venezuela campaign. But I have to say at this point that the government in Venezuela today and the policies the government is following are undermining the gains of the revolution, creating a mood amongst the people where people say, well, this is not what we fought for. This is not what kind of socialism is this. This is not a revolution. We don't want this. I mean, the level of popularity of the approval of the government is now bottom. The lowest has been ever. And we are only lucky that the opposition is so bad, they are also very hated. And so the government is destroying, willingly or unwillingly, destroying the Bolivarian Revolution. Because next to these policies, which do not solve the economic problems of the people, you have corruption, you have bureaucracy, and so on. I'll finish with one example. Just a few days ago, a group of peasants had taken over some plots of land in the state of Barinas, which is a very wealthy agricultural or very fertile land. And they were evicted. They were evicted by whom? They were evicted by the regional land reform institute, which is supposed to be giving land to the peasants away from the landowners. And they were evicted. Not only were they evicted, but the crops were destroyed. The houses where the sheds they had built in this land were destroyed, and all the implements were destroyed, and many of them were put in jail. Now, what are these peasants going to think about the current government? This is not a revolutionary government. From their point of view, it's a counter-revolutionary government, which is collaborating, is having negotiations and talks with the capitalists, while at the same time is attacking the living standards of the people. But I'll warn you about one thing. If the opposition comes to power, and I think that this is now almost inevitable, the minute there are elections in Venezuela, the opposition will win. It's quite clear. And the government knows. And this is the reason why there haven't been elections. But the minute there are elections in Venezuela, the opposition will win, and then this will be terrible. If you think the situation in Venezuela is bad now, and it is, when the opposition wins, the situation will be much worse, because the government is trying to maintain some of the things that exist, even though its policies go to undermine these social gains. You just have to look at what's happening today in Brazil, or what's happening today in Argentina, where there are massive movements. Even in the last few weeks, last few days, last week there was a big movement in Argentina. They've now called for a national strike. Can't remember, I think it's this week, 24th. In Brazil, there was 1 million people on the streets against the reform, the counter-reform of the pensions system. The government wants to abolish the right to strike. This is the real face of counter-revolution in Latin America. And the thing is that the people, the workers, the peasants, and so on, who have fought for 10, 15 years for better living standards, for a change, they will not accept this with their arms folded. They will fight back. And so this is why I'm saying we have not entered the period of counter-revolution. We have entered a different period where left-wing governments were in power before. They didn't go far enough. The policies were not radical enough, not anti-capitalist enough. And now we suffer the consequences with a victory in a number of countries, and more will come of right-wing governments. And this will prepare another wave of popular struggle. The most important thing I will say is to understand the lessons why these governments and these experiences failed or didn't go far enough. And the reason is not because they were socialist, but because they were not socialist enough, because they allowed the capitalist system to continue to exist in this idea that you can maybe coexist or have a bit of each. No, you cannot. If you want to run the economy in the benefit of the majority, you have to expropriate the small, unaccountable, unelected minority that controls the economy. And controls the economy in cahoots and in close links with the imperialist multinationals that are based here in the European Union and in the United States. And I will say the situation is quite favorable for that now, because even in countries like the United States, you have a candidate that calls himself socialist, Bernie Sanders, who obviously didn't win the Democratic nomination because it was rigged against him. But in an opinion poll this week, made by Fox News, they asked people which was the most popular politician or institution in the United States, and it's Bernie Sanders, a guy who calls himself socialist. Well, okay, maybe he's not socialist as I understand it, but the fact that someone who calls himself socialist is so popular in the United States, particularly amongst the youth, is also an indication of the times we live in. Times which are favorable for revolution, for revolutionary change, but times which also require a complete understanding of this experience that has happened in Latin America in the last 15 years, which has not been concluded yet, but where there has been clearly a change of the scenario, and we need to learn the lessons if we are to be able to face the new challenges and the new struggles that are opening up. Thank you.